We have already talked the selection of cooling tower, film and film media. Next is the selection of pumps and water distribution system. There are three areas for energy conservation with pumps and water distribution. Namely, pumps, optimization of cooling water treatment, and installation of drip eliminators. In choosing pumps, of course, we want high efficiency pumps. In the optimization of cooling water treatment, it's mandatory for any cooling tower independent of what film media is. With increasing cost of water, efforts to increase cycles of concentration or COC by cooling water treatment would help to reduce makeup water requirements significantly. In large industries and power plants, improving the COC is often considered a key area for water conservation. The next area for energy conservation with pumps and water distribution is the installation of drift eliminators. It is very difficult to ignore drift problems in cooling towers. Nowadays, most of the end user specifications assume a 0.02% drift loss. But because of the technological developments and the production of PVC, manufacturers have improved drift eliminator designs. As a result, drift losses can now be as low as 0.003 to 0.001%. The last area which can be manipulated to increase the efficiency of cooling towers is the cooling tower fans. The purpose of a cooling tower fan is to move a specified quantity of air through the system. The fan has to overcome the system resistance, which is defined as the pressure loss to move the air. The fan output or work done by the fan is the product of airflow and the pressure loss. The fan output and kilowatt input determines the fan efficiency. The fan efficiency in turn is greatly dependent on the profile of the blade. Metallic blades which are manufactured by extrusion or casting processes, and therefore it is difficult to produce ideal aerodynamic profiles. Fiber reinforced plastic or FRP blades are normally hand molded, which makes it easier to produce an optimum aerodynamic profile tailored to specific duty conditions. Because FRP fans are light, they need a low starting torque, requiring a lower horsepower motor. The lives of the gearbox, motor, and bearings are increased, and maintenance is easier. An 85 to 92% efficiency can be achieved with blades with an aerodynamic profile. Optimum twist, taper, and a high coefficient of lift to coefficient of drop ratio. However, this efficiency is drastically affected by factors such as tip clearance, obstacles to airflow, and inlet shape. Cases reported where metallic or glass fiber reinforced plastic fan blades have been replaced by efficient hollow FRP blades. The resulting fan energy savings could be 20% to 30%. This ends the discussion for the main areas for improving the energy efficiency of the cooling towers. Namely, selection of the right cooling tower, fills, pumps and water distribution system, and fans and motors.
Now we are going to solve a problem about cooling tower. Our main objective here is to solve a problem about cooling tower by means of the nomograph method. But first, we will test its efficiency by solving problems using numerical integration and Chebyshev method. We are given with the following process requirements. First is the total heat load to be removed from several process by cooling tower, which is 20 million BTU per hour. 65 degrees Fahrenheit, which is our wet bulb temperature, or the non-equilibrium temperature at which small amount of water comes into contact with our continuous stream of gas. A dry bulb temperature, or the actual gas temperature of 85 degrees Fahrenheit, and the hot water temperature of 100 degrees Fahrenheit. The approach is 15 degrees Fahrenheit. From here, we can get our cold water temperature just by adding our approach to the wet bulb temperature, which is 65 degrees Fahrenheit. Thus, our cold water temperature is equal to 80 degrees Fahrenheit. We are also given with a water flow rate of 1,000 gallons per minute. The dimensions of our tower is 24 feet by 24 feet. And it has a fan capacity of 130,000 cubic feet per minute. So we are required to get the tower characteristic capable of performing the above process requirements. To do this, we are going to assume that our air reaches its saturation point at 65 degrees Fahrenheit. So using that steam temperature table, we will get the saturation partial pressure of water to be equal to 0.3056 psia at 65 degrees Fahrenheit. And the latent heat of vaporization equals to 1056.88 BTU per pounds. To calculate for the parameter KAV over L, which also refers to the tower characteristic, we will first obtain the saturation humidity, the enthalpy at saturation point, the specific volume of the air-water vapor mixture, the ground area, the liquid loading, the air loading, and the outlet enthalpy of air. Our KAV over L parameter represents or describes our entire tower. K represents the mass transfer coefficient of water in unit of pounds water per hour square foot. And A represents the contact area between our stream of gas and our mixture. It has a unit of square foot per feet cube tower volume. The V indicates the active cooling volume in unit of cubic feet per square foot of land area, and L is the water rate in pounds per hour square foot. Notice that our units for the parameter KAV over L will be cancelled. Thus, KAV over L is unitless. So for we will obtain, then we will get the saturation humidity by using the equation of the ratio of the molar masses of water with air multiplied by the partial pressures of air and water. So 0.3056 multiplied by 18 divided by the product of 14.696 minus 0.3056 and 29. We will get our saturation humidity to be equal to 0.0132 pounds water per pound air. Our saturation enthalpy can be obtained from the equation wherein our enthalpy value will be equated to our saturation humidity multiplied by our saturated temperature plus the saturation humidity multiplied by the latent heat of vaporization plus 0.24 multiplied by the saturation temperature. So by substitution of the values, we will get our saturation enthalpy to be equal to 30.4 BTU per pound. We will get the specific volume of our air-water mixture to further obtain the density of our mixture. So by the equation of assuming that our mixture behaves ideally, we will get our specific volume to be equal to 13.51 feet cubed per pound. The specific volume of air is just equal to 13.24 feet cubed per pound. And the specific volume of water is equal to 0.27 feet cubed per pound. The temperature used in both equations for computing for the specific volume of air and water respectively is 65 degrees Fahrenheit, which is also our wet bulb temperature. Notice that the values obtained from the equations for getting the saturation humidity and saturation enthalpy and the specific volumes of air and water respectively can be found directly on the enthalpies and humidities of air-water vapor mixtures table shown in Table 1. Next, we will get the ground area. We will just simply multiply the given tower dimensions, which are 24 feet by 24 feet. So we will get our ground area to be equal to 576 feet squared. The liquid loading is just equal to total hourly water rate divided by the ground area. So we are given with 1,000 gallons per minute multiplied by a conversion factor of 500 divided by the ground area of 576 square feet. We will get our liquid loading to be equal to 868 pounds per hour square feet. The air loading will be obtained by using the values for fan capacity and the specific volume. The reciprocal of the specific volume is just equal to the density of our mixture. So we will divide 1 by 13.51 to get our density. Our density for the mixture is just equal to 0.074 pounds per feet cubed. Our air loading is just equal to the fan capacity multiplied by the density of the mixture divided by the ground area. So our air loading will be equal to 1,002 pounds per hour feet squared by substitution. Then we are going to get the L over G ratio. It is just equal to 0.8662. This is done by simply dividing the liquid loading value by the air loading value.